great prophet. Daniel chapter 10. Daniel chapter 10. Let's stand together, please, as we honor the word. Daniel 10, verse 1. In the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a thing was revealed unto Daniel, whose name was called Belteshazzar. And the thing was true, but the time appointed was long. And he understood the thing and had understanding of the vision. In those days, I, Daniel, was mourning 3 full weeks. I ate no pleasant bread, neither came flesh nor wine in my mouth, neither did I anoint myself at all, till 3 whole weeks were fulfilled. And in the 4th and 20th day of the first month, as I was by the side of the great river, which is Hiddekel, then I lift up mine eyes and looked, and behold, a certain man, clothed in linen, whose loins were girded with the fine gold of Uphaz. His body also was like the beryl, and his face as the appearance of lightning, and his eyes as lamps of fire, and his arms and his feet like in color to polished brass. And the voice of his words like the voice of a multitude. And I, Daniel, alone saw the vision, for the men that were with me saw not the vision, but a great quaking fell upon them, so that they fled to hide themselves. Therefore I was left alone, and saw this great vision. There remained no strength in me, for my comeliness was turned into me, into corruption, and I retained no strength. Yet heard I the voice of his words. And when I heard the voice of his words, then was I in a deep sleep on my face, and my face toward the ground. And behold, a hand touched me, which set me up upon my knees and upon the palms of my hands. And he said to me, O Daniel, a man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak unto thee, and stand upright. For unto thee am I now sent. And when he had spoken this word unto me, I stood trembling. Then said he unto me, Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that thou didst set thine heart to understand and to chasten thyself before thy God, thy words were heard, and I am come for thy words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 1 and 20 days, but lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. Now I am come to make thee understand what shall befall thy people in the latter days. For yet the vision is for many days. May God bless his word to our hearing and understanding. The final vision, majesty and mystery. I think it was time to open the curtains. There was a baptism in the small church in West Texas. They were building a new sanctuary. And it was time for the baptism, and the new baptistry was functional, but they did not have any changing rooms. So they improvised, as we do sometimes, hang sheets or put little curtains out on the side. Well, everything was going well until the last person to be baptized. She was terrified of water. And the pastor assured her everything was going to be all right, like I do some folks sometimes. Well, she panicked. And you know what a panic person does? Start going all kinds of ways. By the time she reached over and she grabbed the first thing she could grab a hold of, and that was a curtain, a sheet, hanging to the side, which was to block the previous ones who were baptized. It was a little barrier. And it was from the men's changing room. Down came the curtain. There stood a man wearing nothing but his underwear. He realized something was dreadfully wrong, because everybody in the congregation was looking at him, and he saw them eye to eye. It was very much an embarrassment. But he did the only thing sensible. He dived right back into the baptistry with the lady and the pastor. And if you know who this is, Dennis Swanberg. How many have heard of Dennis Swanberg? Well, he tells that story, the great Christian comedian, and was a pastor, you know, for years. This is what he said. We just dismiss the service. Well, I tell you that story to get us started tonight and think about the prophecy of Daniel 10. It says in verse 8, he saw a great vision. Now, Daniel saw great visions because he was a man that God used in great prophecy. It's like he just pulls back the curtains. God says, I want to pull it back, Daniel, and show you these great things that are coming. See, God wants us to see faithful Daniel tonight. Now, you must realize it's been some weeks since we left Daniel. Daniel was already in his 80s. Now he's upper 80s in years of age. We want to take a picture of the Lord Jesus tonight. And then we want to see the battle, spiritual battle that rages then and now and in the future in the heavenlies. First of all, the preparation for the vision. Verses 1 through 4. Daniel 10 and 1 through 4. Now, it says in verse 1, it's the third year of King Cyrus of Persia. Now, what happened in the first year of King Cyrus? God placed on a pagan ruler's heart to get the people out of Babylon, send them back to Jerusalem, back to Israel. See, they were in the Babylonian captivity. This is why Daniel went early as a teenage young fellow. Now they're returning back to the homeland. Daniel gets word that when they return back, they're so upset with the enemies around, they haven't done anything but lay a slab to the temple in 2 years. They're supposed to build the temple, rebuild their lives, get the priest. Ezra was back there then. Nehemiah came on later, you know, to help build the walls and so forth. But there's a span of time going on. And the people are just so confused, discouraged, they didn't know what's going on. So the word gets back to Daniel. Daniel's brokenhearted for the people of God, for the temple of God, the work of God. Progress is very little. That's in verse 2. Well, the Bible tells us something happened in verse 2. In those days, I, Daniel, was mourning. This is not getting up in the morning. It is M-O-U-R-N. Great brokenness, great sorrow. His heart is surrendered. He's humbling himself, and he's confessing the sins of the people and his own sins. He's fasting. He's not eating, he's not drinking, he's not oiling. Now, it's not like oiling the car, but it says he didn't have any anointing oil because they put oil on their bodies. If you were out in that old desert land and barren land like it was in Babylon, the heat burns you up. It burns your skin unless you put oil on you. So, he didn't put anything on him, didn't eat anything, didn't drink anything. He's just praying, interceding, calling upon God, the quietness of his heart, pleading with God. Let's get serious here. There's a great application here. When have you spent 21 minutes with the Lord this week in a row? Have you sat down with this word called, we call it Holy Bible, Holy Word of God, read it, marked it, prayed over it, prayed for someone else for 21 minutes? The Bible says 21 days, 3 weeks. What about 21 hours this last month? There's 24 hours in a day, 30 days a month. You ever consider what God might do with us personally, in our families, in our churches, if we devoted as much time to the Word of God and prayer as we do to eating and drinking? Well, Daniel was very serious about getting connected to the Lord. He's burdened for God's ministry, God's people. He didn't run to counselors. He didn't run to friends and neighbors. He went straight to the source, Almighty God, in humble prayer. The story is told of Andrew Bonner. He's a pastor in the late 1800s. His daughter one day took a Welsh evangelist through the church where Andrew, her father, pastored. Now, a little girl said, "Daddy brought me back here, set me in a pew in the back one evening. And he said, 'Now, honey, you sit here and I'll be back in just a little while.'" So one day she decided to find out what Daddy was doing. Well, she slipped up the aisle and she said, "I saw the strangest thing, sir. My daddy was bent over at the end of the pew. It looked like he was reading some kind of name. Did you know there are plaques on pews? Y'all might have been in churches where they used to have plaques, people maybe to memorialize someone you know that had died or something in your family. You put that name on the plaque, you see. Well, anyway, she said he's bent his head down there and he read a name. He prayed over that name and family. Then he scoot over in another pew and he bent over and he called out the name. See, he didn't know she was watching him. He said, "That's what my daddy was doing." He said he stayed there a long time, several hours that evening. He spent the entire evening in prayer. He had a great burden on his heart for the people. This is a picture of Daniel. Brother Daniel spent 3 weeks talking and listening to God. What a great fellowship that must have been. Well, it says, it seems like we get a picture here. Just imagine, after he got up through praying for the 3 weeks, it said he took a little walk. Now, that's not exactly what it says, but you've got to get the picture. It says he's going beside the river. He didn't say he's walking in the river. He's walking beside the river. Have you taken a walk lately? You know, there's a good science about walking. Did you know that? I saw somebody running today. He's a young fella. He looked like he was hassling. I was about to pull over. I said, "Sir, why don't you just come with me and take a walk instead of hassling like you're doing?" But he loved to run, I guess. Steve, you love to run. That's fine. You know people who love to run. That's great. I'm just not going to run. I love to walk, though. Well, anyway, Daniel, he goes down walking beside the riverside. It's called Hiddekel. Now, some translations say Tigris, the Tigris River. We know that runs through Iraq and into Iran. It's the Persian, the great river over there. Well, there the Lord revealed to Daniel his great vision, there in verse 8, beside the cool waters, walking in God's great air, in the sunshine, listening to God. So I want you to think about that tonight, the preparation for the vision. It was in serious prayer and fellowship with God. Secondly, tonight, I want to talk about the person of Jesus. Person of Jesus. Now, most believe, most writers, most commentators believe this is a picture of the pre-incarnate Jesus. Now, this is not Jesus when he was here, came 2,000 years ago. Jesus is the eternal Son of God. He can appear where he wants to appear. God can send him, the Father can send his Son anytime he wants him. And there are times in the Old Testament that Jesus came. Well, look here in verses 5 and 6. "Clothed in linen with gold, his body like beryl, a beryl, his face like lightning, eyes like fire, arms and feet like brass, and a voice like the voice of a multitude." Now, how do you say this is Jesus? Well, listen to this and what the Bible says in Revelation chapter 1. You don't have to turn there. You can mark it down in your Bible if you don't have a study Bible that says that maybe. Listen to what these verses say. Revelation 1, 13 and following. "In the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot and a girdle about the paps with a golden girdle." Golden. "His head and his hairs are white like wool, as white as snow. His eyes were as flame of fire, and his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters." Does that sound like the picture Daniel saw? Almost exactly. Now let's talk about the Lord Jesus. This wasn't the first time Daniel was exposed to Jesus. The pre-incarnate Jesus. Chapter 2, Jesus was called the stone not cut by human hands. He would crush the kingdoms of the world. Chapter 4, there was the fourth man walking in the fiery furnace. Remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Who knows the Hebrew names tonight? I'll give you $5 if you can tell me. You can't look back though, because you ain't going to have time. You can't do that. You can't cheat me tonight. Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah.
That's the Hebrew boys. Well, we know them as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. That was in chapter 4 in the fiery furnace. Remember that fourth person? Believed to be Jesus. Chapter 7, he's called the Son of Man, given an everlasting kingdom. That's none other than Lord Jesus. Chapter 8, he's the Prince of Princes, comes to defeat Antichrist in the future. Prince of Princes. That Jesus. Chapter 9, the last chapter we studied, Jesus called the Anointed One. He's cut off 483 years after the decree to rebuild Jerusalem. He was cut off where? At the cross. Death on the cross. So, Daniel's already had pictures of Jesus. Visions given him. But let's get a deeper view here of the majesty of Jesus. Look at his clothing. It says a white linen robe. See that? It's a symbol of purity. In the ancient times, only a king could wear a golden sash. Who is Jesus? The number one king. King of kings. Lord of lords. The greatest. He reigns. He's a sovereign lord. He's a royal king. That's what his clothing is pictured as. Second picture is body. Appearance of lightning. Well, I don't know about you. I saw some interesting things this past week, and I'm so thankful we were not involved in that. But I want you to know this. Do not go out and say because Arkansas, Alabama, certain places in our country, people died because they're not living right. I'm telling you, there's some Christian people died, friends. Those who love Jesus died in that great tornadoes this past week. You're talking about lightning falling, powerful winds. It's terrible. You go down into a basement cellar, and then you open the lid, and you look out on your house. It's flat. I mean, there's nothing but a slab of concrete. That didn't get to your heart. That'll tell you something. But I'm so thankful many survived, and there are others who died, saving their own families and so forth. You may have heard of that. But anyway, the sky is lit up, friends. I don't want to be a part of that. It's terrible to think about. But anyway, the appearance of lightning, of a storm, so bright and powerful. It said Jesus' body, he like a brilliant flash of light. It speaks of his radiance. John chapter 1, 1 John chapter 1, God is light. Jesus is the true light. What an amazing picture that is. Remember when Moses came down from Mount Sinai receiving the Ten Commandments? He says he had to hide his face in a veil. His face shone with the glory of God. It was so bright. Beautiful. This is a brilliance that we're talking about. And this is a vision that Daniel would see of Jesus. Next we look at his eyes. His eyes like lamps of fire. Flame. Burning. You know, you ever read in the Gospels where it said Jesus, one of the Pharisees and the scribes and all, one day they mocked Jesus for helping a man with his withered hand, the paralyzed hand. Remember that? And he healed him on the Sabbath. And they started mocking Jesus. And he said, Jesus turned and looked at them in anger. How do you think his eyes looked at them? Think he was smiling from ear to ear? No, when they saw his face and he looked at them, his eyes burned through their heart. And they knew it, you see, because he's God, the eternal one. Peter, it says, you know, Peter denied Jesus three times and the rooster crowed. He said Jesus was over on the side and he turned and looked at Peter. It burned in his heart, you see. This is the picture of Jesus. You ever consider how the Lord Jesus looks at you and me? Deep, searching, flaming fire. You might picture that. Say, I know what's on the inside of you, Don. I know what your wife doesn't know. I know what your children don't know. I know what the church doesn't know. When I look at you, and my eye pierces your heart, I know what's inside of you, what you're thinking, what your desires are. Says about his arms like polished brass. Brass or bronze, a symbol of strength. arms, the hands of the Lord Jesus, fashioning the universe, worked with his earthly father Joseph in the carpenter's shop, lifted up his hands to heaven and blessed the people. He touched the lepers and the blind and the lame and he healed them. He picked up the precious little children in his arms and he held them and blessed them. Then in a few years, they were cut. His hands were nailed and his feet and his arms were spread back, open wide because of our shame and punishment and sin. He took it upon himself. What about those beautiful arms today? He's reaching out to people, calling them to come today. He's reaching out to a lost young man. He's reaching out to the elderly, broken saint. He's reaching out to a weak, burdened child. He's reaching out to all ages and all races and all religious peoples, all atheists and all helpless people, all sexually immoral people, all kinds of people. His arms are reaching out, saying, "Come unto me." Daniel said, "I saw his feet. They were also as brass, a symbol of protection, durable, strong, tough." You ever thought about where Jesus walked on the dusty roads and the rocks of Israel? Walked on the troubled waters of the Sea of Galilee. His feet were like bronze. They were tough and durable. The Bible says in Ephesians 1 and 22, God's put all things under his feet. Where are you walking in life's journey today? Easy places, rough places, dangerous places, defeating places. Be sure to walk with Jesus. Walk in the footsteps of Jesus. Then he said his voice was like the voice of a multitude. How many have ever been to the mini dome? Been to the mini dome? How many have been to any kind of outdoor stadium, like in the football games and all? And what happens when a few voices start raising? People start standing and shouting. There's a voice, like many voices, a multitude of voices. When Jesus spoke, Daniel says, it sounds like a multitude of voices ringing out of that one voice. What a picture. You know, God speaks in wonderful ways. I think most of the time he speaks in a still, small voice, but sometimes he can speak powerfully as thousands of voices at one time. Then he's going to send his angels one day. Thousands will be singing. The Bible said no man ever spake like this man. See, he's more than a man. They didn't know it. He's God. Jesus was God who became man. Let me ask you, do you think Buddha ever said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me"? You think Muhammad said, "For God so loved the world that he gave me to die on a cross, then to be raised the third day"? Did Muhammad ever say that? He ever claimed that? What about Confucius? Do you ever have such wise words as, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly of heart. You'll find rest for your soul." Did he ever say that? Did he ever claim that? What voice said that? None other than the Lord Jesus. See the majesty, the very presence of the Holy One. And what happened to Daniel when he was in the presence of the majesty, the King? What did the Bible say? Look with me. Verse 8, "I was left alone when I saw this vision. There remained what in me? Zero strength." No strength? I say very much a weakness, wasn't it? You ever heard of being zapped? You ever heard of that? You may have said it before. Now, I want to say a word about being zapped here. For Brother Don Sparks, after his wife got a hold of him downstairs this week, he was a worn out, zapped man. Putting all those things, cleaning out all those cabinets, And she stood up there and sat down and told him what to do. No, she did. She helped. She helped. I saw her sometime. She really worked too, so I just kidding. Anyway, there are times, you know what I'm saying, when you work so hard that you just feel wiped out. Isn't that true? You know what I'm saying. Well, this is Brother Daniel. He's prayed for 3 weeks. He hasn't eaten. He hasn't drunk anything. And now he sees Jesus in all of his glorious majesty. He's out. Well, there's a great application here. You stay with me. He's crumbling down on his knees. Now, in verse 9, he said his face is on the ground. You see that in the scripture? His face is in the ground. In the presence of the Lord and the majesty of our Lord is so powerful, you're going to fall out in his presence. A man went to the pastor at the end of the service one day and he said, I got to talk to you, pastor. I've been seeing the Lord often in great visions. The pastor said, all right. He said, you know, Jesus comes and talks with me while I'm shaving. Pastor said, oh, yeah? He said, when you see Jesus, do you stop shaving? He said, oh, no. He said, well, I doubt very seriously if you've ever seen Jesus, because when he gets hold of you, he will put you down, down, down in humility. You won't be standing up shaving. Y'all ladies won't be brushing your hair so beautifully, putting on your makeup. It'll be the greatness and the majesty of the Lord be so powerful. You'll be trembling in his presence. Shaken down. Maybe blinded for moments. Your face hidden. Attitude of humility and worship is so powerful. People talk about awesome. That's what I'm saying awesome is. In a terror of the Lord. In his great power. God's glory. You cannot stand in the face of the glory of God. This is part of Daniel's understanding. Now let's move on quickly. The mystery of the angels. We're going to talk a few moments about the battle in the heavenlies. Verses 10 through 17, in 10 and 12, the scene changes now. No longer are we picturing Jesus. Daniel, standing before Daniel, is an angel we believe is Gabriel. Said the Bible said he touches him, lifts him, gives him words of great comfort. Fear not. Throughout history, when God wants his servant to wake up and say be strong and courageous, he uses what words? Fear not. Do not be afraid. I am with you. See? Is what he's telling Daniel. I can hear him say, Brother Daniel, you're my friend. God sent me here on purpose. Your prayers have been heard. See, you must understand something, friends. How old was Daniel when they sent him walking captive to Babylon? 15, 16, or 17. Joe, I don't know exactly what age it was there, but he's a teenager. Remember that? In all those years, praying, seeking God's will, seeking the visions of God, telling what God told him to tell the kings, working through all those kingships, pagan land, heathens. Brother Daniel, your prayers have been heard for a long time, not just these 21 days. God's been hearing you for a long time, brother. See, the answer didn't come on the first day. It didn't come on day 10. It didn't come on day 20. It was going to come on day 21. He kept knocking. It's time to go down to help Brother Daniel, my favorite faithful servant. There's a great lesson here on prayer, perseverance in prayer, continuing prayer. Someone says, we're getting ready to get ready for revival service. Somebody said, well, I've been praying for my a friend to be saved. I said, how long you prayed for him? Oh, maybe 5 days.
5 days?
What about 50 days? What about 50 weeks? What about 5 years, 10 years?
Don't give up on God. Families in financial crisis.
Well, I've been praying about it. How long have you been praying? Oh, last night I found out I need a bill paid.
First time I prayed.
No. You need to ask wisdom from God every day that you live. Ask for His help. Jesus said in Matthew 7:7, ask and seek and knock. It's keep on. It's perseverance. Verse 13 we find here in the Scripture. There's a battle going on between heaven and earth. You see this? The prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 1 and 20 days. This is Gabriel, that great angel. He's God's good angel. The prince of the kingdom of Persia is an evil angel, fallen angel. Isn't it interesting? It took place for 21 days, the same time Daniel's been praying to the Holy God. God's angel, Gabriel, had to call for some backup. And there was Michael, the Bible says in verse 13. He sent low Michael, one of the chief princes. He showed up and put a whipping on the devil's angel. He said, now Gabriel, go ahead and continue on down so you can help Brother Daniel. What about bad, evil angels? What are you talking about, Pastor? Well, you know where the first angel came from, don't you? Isaiah 14. Lucifer. Apparently he was a great angel in heaven. He said, oh, I want to rise up and take God's place. I want to take the Most High. I will ascend up. God said, all right, I'll put my foot to you. Poof! Kicked him right out, didn't he? Satan, Lucifer, the devil. He's in the supernatural realm, you know. He got up his angel army. That's evil angels. We hear the word of God in Revelation 12:7. There was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. The dragon and his angels fought back. John 12:31 speaks about Satan, still God of this world system. What's he called there in John 12:31? Prince of this world. It's little p, not capital P, but little p. Little prince. Christians, you better wake up. We do not wrestle against flesh and blood. Think of that. You see all these things going on in the world? Governments, leaders, and all that. Guess what? There's something happening up in the heavenlies, between heaven and earth. Got God's angels, you've got evil angels. That's what the Brother Paul talks about in Ephesians chapter 6. It's against principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of this world, against the spiritual wickedness in high places. Like the demon angel assigned to the nation of Persia. You see that, don't you, in verse 13, the prince of the kingdom of Persia. That's an evil angel. Satan is giving him orders. Don't you think that Satan is giving orders today in America, in Russia, in China, South America, all over this world? Government, courts, financial systems, education system, our families. Pharaoh down in Egypt. He oppressed the people of God. Don't think that there wasn't a bad angel set up with him. Nebuchadnezzar, he could never learn until God sent his mighty angel to wake him up and put him out in the pasture. Let him eat like an animal, eat grass. His claws grew, looked like a wild man. Paul's ministry. Nero came to Rome. He blamed the Christian. He hated him, killed him, tortured the Christian. Don't you think he didn't have a demon-possessed angel? The last century, the demon-possessed scourge of Europe named Hitler. You better listen carefully now. Listen carefully. We always hear about this Holocaust of 6 million Jews being killed. Now watch this. The story is told that Hitler was ready to go on any major campaign or battle. He's telling them to go toward England, go toward Russia, go anywhere. It's North Africa, you see. They were on the move everywhere. Listen. The night before every battle, he communed with the spirit world. He was in touch with his prince of evil. And you think about that. Evil angels commissioned by the devil himself to intervene into governments and to leaders. Now, friends, spiritual warfare is serious. If Daniel shows it right here. The devil has his warrior angels on the move in many nations. Just open your eyes. He is bent on destroying you first. Me, our families, our churches, our schools, the government he's interested in. Did you know everything Satan's touched, he destroyed it? Anything he gets his hands on, he'll destroy it. Well, we better wake up. Arise. Turn on the alert sirens in your soul. We're called to resist the devil. I want you to memorize. I want you to take this down. If you haven't taken anything else down, take these two verses down. Go home and write and quote them every day. James 4:7. James 4:7. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Now, just don't say resist the devil and he'll flee. It says submit to God. Surrender to the God who loves you in Jesus Christ. And as his follower, if Jesus is Lord, then the devil can't be Lord. You follow what I'm saying? You must resist him in the name of Jesus the Christ, the Savior of the world, your Savior, and your Lord. Don't give up on Jesus, and don't give in to the devil. The great promise, 1 John 4:4. Many of you quoted that many times. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And now I want you to put this. HS means Holy Spirit. Little ES means evil spirit. All right? And then you'll get the picture. Greater is he, Jesus Christ, who put the Holy Spirit in us, Christian. He's in you as a Christian than he that's in the world. The evil spirit, the devil, he's going to get in you if you allow him. But not through Jesus he won't. And that's a promise. And you bank on that and you hold on to it. And when the trials come and when Satan wants to take you apart, send you to the wrong places, tell you to do the wrong things, live the wrong way, you say, no, in the name of Jesus Christ, my Savior, Lord, I stand against you. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for the power of the prophecy of Daniel. And we pray tonight we got a real glimpse of our wonderful Lord Jesus, even in this prophecy. And then to know that the mystery, it's a kind of a mystery. Bad angels and good angels fighting above us and around us. And oh God, tonight, we thank you that you said in your word in the Psalm 91 that you send forth your angels to guard your loved ones, to keep us in all your ways. What a wonderful picture tonight. Thank you for watching over us, protecting us. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The Lord's speaking to your heart. You come tonight. If you need salvation, you need church membership, if you need prayer, whatever it is, you come as God speaks to your heart. Would you do that? Let's stand together and sing. Come, brother.